So it is my pleasure to be here and give you just a little flavor of the exciting scientific discoveries that we have recently made. As you just heard, this is new, very, very new. So about 15, 17 years ago, whether or not there are planets out there was a great discussion, and you needed a bottle of wine and a couple of friends to try to figure out who believed what. But now, we can actually already measure, find planets around other stars. And I'll show you how we go about already characterizing what they could be like. And in that, also learn about our own planet. And you just saw a picture of our own Earth. And so you also see that here. You see a picture of our own Earth. And I actually, for a little bit, allow myself to change the title of this symposium, just a tiny, tiny bit. But we're talking about the big picture, new concepts for new worlds. Because what we're really doing is we're finding whole new worlds out there. And let me take you on this journey also visibly. So this is a picture of our own Earth. And we're actually moving away from our own planet because right now we're discovering, of course, the universe around us. But we are always also trying to discover the first planets like our own out there. And this is actually data from MESSENGER. It's a satellite that moved to Mercury to characterize one of the planets of our own system. And while doing that, it had a swing by the Earth, and it's kind of like a sling, which just used the Earth's gravity to change its course to get to Mercury with as little fuel as possible. And that's data, so that's real photography from the Earth. It's not an artist image anymore. But let me set this whole thing in context. So, just so you know, we are here. And so what you see here is the picture of our galaxy. And our galaxy, we don't have a picture of our galaxy. That's the first thing I want to say. But by looking around, we can figure out which ones of the other galaxies out there look exactly like our own. And this is how we know what the shape of our galaxy is, because we have no satellite that went all the way up and took a picture, looked back at the galaxy and took a picture. We have never gotten that far. This is huge distance to travel. But you can look around and find something akin to our own galaxy, akin to our sun, to understand how it actually forms and how it dies, and now akin to our own planet. So you're roughly one-third out from the center. And to give you a feeling about how many stars we're talking in one galaxy alone, if you take all the sand, all the rocks, all the pebbles you can find on the Earth, pile it up, it's not as many stars as are out there in the sky. Just to give you a feeling what we're talking about. And of course, this is not the only galaxy out there. We have millions and millions of galaxies, and we're finding more and more. And so, now you have a feeling where we are in terms of space in our own galaxy. And I actually took you out a little bit from our Earth when we moved away with the satellite. And this is how we look like. That is the furthest away picture of our own Earth that we have. And if you have a look at these stripes, what you do see is this small, tiny point in the middle. And that is us. That's the picture of the Earth. The furthest away picture we took. And of course, you remember when you have a picture of something and something bright is next to it, you get these stripes in your normal digital images. It's the same here. There's, of course, bright stars, there's the sun. So these stripes are just artifacts of a camera that gets a lot of light from somewhere else. But this tiny point that you see here was taken by Voyager. And Voyager went to see Saturn, the other planets in our own system, and then Carl Sagan said, you know what, why don't we turn this thing around just to get a picture of what we look like if you're out in space? And for a feeling, if you shrink the sun to the size of a sugar grain, then our whole planetary system fits within whatever cookie you like. I usually use Oreos, and I was about to bring some, but that would be the marketing. So whatever cookie you like, next time you eat it, just remember, if the sun is the size of a sugar grain, that's the size of our solar system. And to give you a feeling for space, or what we're talking about, the next star that actually just exists around, in that scale, when our whole solar system fits in a cookie, is 2 football fields away. That's how far that is. Just think about, we just made it to Mars, what's amazing. Light needs 14 minutes, or that signal needs 14 minutes to get back to us. But what we're doing is, here, we're still in this cookie. Voyager looked around before it left our solar system, you know, the rim of your favorite cookie, and had a look around and saw our Earth. But with current technology, Voyager left 1977 from Earth, with current technology, we can find planets that are still a bit bigger around stars that are, in this whole scale, football fields away, really far away. So technology and the ability to use light allows us to characterize planets that are light years, very, very far away. And I said this was taken from a digital camera in 1977. If you think about what kind of digital camera you could have bought in 1977, you would be going with something this big that has like 1 pixel. So we redid this experiment, or they redid this experiment. But first, I just wanted to say, for this picture on the rim of the cookie, remember, so from Mars, it's 14 minutes to us. From the sun, it's 8 minutes to us for light. This took 5 hours and 40 minutes to get the signal to us, and that's the speed of light. So that's really the furthest away picture we ever had of our own planet. And if you haven't read it, there's a beautiful, beautiful part that Carl Sagan wrote about this picture. And he said, or today in the morning somebody said, you put an astronaut in space and he becomes a poet, a philosopher. And in a way, I think a lot of scientists have this curiosity ingrained. And if you see pictures like that, this tiny point suspended in the vastness of space, if you want, I think everybody will wonder and everybody will express that wonder. And Sagan did a beautiful job by actually saying, just think about it. Everybody you've ever known, you've ever heard of, who's ever lived, who's ever loved, and he goes on and says, every crooked politician, every hero, whatever you want, has been on this tiny white dot. Because for now, we have not yet found another one. And so I said, let's increase technology, and here I give you another picture of the Earth. And that's usually when I teach, when one of my students is like, professor, and I'm like, yeah, and he's like, that's not the Earth. So that is, of course, not the Earth. You see the rings, it's Saturn. But if you have a look at the left, just a little above the inner rings, you see a tiny white point. And that is the Earth. And that is a picture with 1990s technology. So we are getting better. But I wanted to show you this picture because a lot of times when you hear about what we're discovering, which planets we're discovering, you hear about them being big and gaseous. Well, have a look at the picture. Which one of the two is easier to find? So as technology gets better, we're getting smaller and smaller planets, of course, but for now, it's way easier to find and characterize the big ones. But how do we actually do that? I showed you a picture of our own planet, still within our solar system. We looked back 5 hours for the light to reach us, and it was tiny, it was a tiny point. So most of the planet that we are finding, we're actually not finding by seeing it directly. What we do is we use that the planet actually tacks at the star, if you have a look. When the planet goes around the star, it actually, its gravity tucks at the star, and the star moves back and forth. It's very comparable that if somebody goes and walks a dog, for example, if the dog's really heavy and wants to go and you don't, even if you don't see the dog, you will see that this person gets dragged along by something. And in a way, that's what we're using because the planet moves around the star. And it is a shift in the wavelength and the light of the star that's comparable to the shift of the sound if an ambulance comes towards you or goes away from you, so Doppler shift. And if this is periodic, you know that the star goes towards you, goes away from you, towards you, and away from you. And that tells you that something moves around it, and it's making the counter movement. So a lot of these planets we find indirectly, not directly. We look at the star. And then, as you've seen in the last part of this animation, if just by chance we're looking in the right direction, so if by chance the geometrical alignment is correct, or so that this planet goes between us and the star, the planet actually, in a way, casts a shadow or blocks out part of the hot stellar light. And so the star dims very periodically. Whenever the planet goes in front of it, the light will go down a little bit. There's going to be less light from the star. And so you can also use that to infer that there's a planet in there. And of course, for both these methods, if you think about it, it's way easier to find big, heavy things. Whether or not it talks at the star, or whether or not it blocks out part of the stellar light. And so, if you now actually put everything together that we found, we have found more than 800 planets around other stars already. And that's within the last 70 years. And it's insofar funny because every year this number doubles. So it is one of the scientific fields where it actually you have an exponential growth. I remember 95 when the first one around a solar type star was found. I just started to study and a lot of people were saying, girl, you shouldn't do science fiction. They have one exoplanet and they'll have the next one in about 50 years to come. And so fortunately for me, they were very wrong because technology picked up. And we have found more than 800, and right now we're vetting another 2,500 candidates. So we're finding lots of planets out there. It seems like every second star, at least, has a planet. And so, if I now make a list, I say, okay, here are the big planets, here are the small planets. So, because it's much easier to find the big ones, you should have lots of them here. And the small ones are very tricky to find, so you should have only a couple of them there. And that's what we expected. And then we did the plot. And so here's when, again, when it moves in front of the star and blocks part of the light. So from both of these methods, very independently, we get the same results. And what you see here on the left is the radius of the planets we find. And you see the 1, that means 1 Earth radius. And you see the 10, that means about Jupiter. So I depicted the planets here. But you see that we have many, many, many more small planets, but we're so much more sensitive to the small ones. And that only works to have this distribution if there's so many more of the small ones out there that even so, we're less sensitive to those. The number is just overwhelming all of our results. So it looks as if most of the planets out there are really small, and I shaded in this area on the left between 1 and 2 Earth radii because with current technology, we're starting to approach this region, and you see some numbers here. So basically, the y-axis is the number of planets, and the x-axis is the radius of them. But you see that we are not complete in that region yet. So there's a lot of interesting surprises out there. And so you might have heard about the Kepler mission. And what the Kepler mission does, it's a NASA satellite. It's about 1 meter. And it keeps staring at 150,000 stars, trying to find this blocking of the light of the star. So it looks at 150,000 stars and tries to figure out if the planet goes around it. And if you want to compare it, take a tennis ball, stretch out your hand, put it against the sky. That's exactly the part of the sky that Kepler covers. In that part of the sky, size of a tennis ball, outstretched arm, you find 150 stars. And so here you see some of the interesting things we found with Kepler. This is, for example, a system that was the first system actually that showed lots of planets. And this is, of course, an artist's impression, remember? This is like tiny, tiny points of light. But we found many systems that show more planets like ours. Even so, you by chance have to just look at it right. And it's very tightly packed. So these five planets, if you would put it overplotted in our own system, would be closer than Venus's orbit to the star. So there seem to be planets wherever you can make them. And this is the artist's impression for a certain date. And this is how it looks like when it gets published. For example, in Nature, this is six new worlds discovered out there. And we're finding more and more of those. So one of the things is that I wanted to give you just the flavor of the diversity of planets. So here you see just the multiple planetary systems that we have found already with Kepler. And you see that there are big planets, small planets, many planets, not so many planets. So there's a big variety out there. And as I said before, most of these planets are really big because it's just easier, or most of the ones we can characterize are really big because it's easier to characterize big star planets. And some of them, if you, for example, ever watch Star Wars, have more than one sun. So you see there are a couple of systems that actually have two suns, and you see a planet orbiting both of them. So in a way, how life of these planets, if they were there, would exist would be interesting, because you'd have one sunrise, then you'd have a second one. And the question is if you'd ever have a night in the whole area. And then it's also so much easier to find planets that are very close to their star, just because you don't have to wait so long for them to come back around. Because the Earth takes a year to go around the sun. So if you want to find it, you have to wait for a year to catch the first transit. But then these small planets that I was talking about, we know already a couple that are small enough, we know the radius and the mass, to be rocky. But right now, currently, they're still so hot that on the whole surface, there should be lava, because it's just so close to the star. And little by little, we're finding the ones that are further and further away, thus cool enough to have liquid water on their surface and potentially provide the conditions for life. And here you see also an artist's impression where we fly over the surface of such a planet that's completely covered in lava. And again, there's scientific information in there, but what the topography and how the lava looks like is completely made up in the scientific endeavor. But what we do find already, I said that there's a region which just warm enough that the water isn't frozen because you're close enough to the star, but just cold enough that it's not so hot that you evaporate all of it, like when you stay around a bonfire. And in that region that we call the habitable zone, we already found a couple of planets. And what you see here is Kepler 22, that's still too big to be a rocky planet, but just slight too big to be a rocky planet. So we're basically waiting for the next planet that is smaller in there. And if you have that planet, how can you figure out if it could have conditions like the Earth? Because Venus and the Earth are pretty similar if you think about it in mass and radius. But what you see here is a picture from the shuttle that a colleague of mine took. And here you see the atmosphere of the Earth and you see the sunrise. And this atmosphere, even so it's this tiny slither, and every time I see that, I'm really, really reminded to be extremely careful of our planet. This atmosphere holds all the information that you can remotely, without going there, use to figure out if a planet would be habitable. So you see, if our planet would go in front of the star that's depicted on the upper right, then if you split out the light from red to blue, so just in its components, and then you see absorption features very characteristic for certain chemicals at different wavelengths. And so ozone or oxygen and methane, a reducing gas in combination, plus water, is really the fingerprint for life on a habitable planet. That's what we're looking for. And in comparison, here you see Venus and Mars. Venus is the yellow line in the middle, and Mars is the red one. They only show CO2. So those two planets don't show indications for habitability. but our Earth, the blue line up there, shows ozone, water, and then it's not included here, but here on the left, there's also CH4 feature. So it distinguishes Earth from the other planets in our own solar system that are rocky but not habitable. And here I just depicted this blue part, this blue line here shows you where the habitable region is around a star. Star is smaller, you need to be closer by not to freeze, like with a bonfire. Star is bigger, you see the sun on top. The sun is a normal star. You want to be further away. And it starts to get populated with small planets. We're starting to find more and more of these small planets out there. So what this depicts here is just the amount of planets we find per year. You go up here in this image, and you find more and more planets by year that we find, and they're also starting to be numerous and small. But for now, whether or not any of those have life is complete speculation, because we need the atmosphere. We need the information from the atmosphere, and the first time we can do that is actually with the follow-up of Hubble, the James Webb Telescope, to find that. And then, of course, how that life would be like is another big speculation. Mostly, it's probably bacteria, because most of the time, life on the Earth was pretty simple, and I get myself into trouble with the biologist when I say simple life. Life always seems to be complicated. But highly advanced, we don't know how many there could be. But it's fun, again, with a bottle of wine to go to that question, because right now, that one we can't answer yet. But if you think about the big picture, this puzzle that we are assembling, we are finding other worlds already out there. More, a couple of hundreds, and they're going to be more and more out there, and a few of them already in the right distance to potentially be like the Earth. So it's a big puzzle to solve that also will allow us to understand our Earth much better, because find a couple of older Earths, younger Earths, try to figure out what it takes for a planet to be habitable, and maybe have a glimpse into our future. And this is where this big picture also comes back to. We have the Earth, one example. If we could find just a couple more at different stages in their evolution, it would help us a lot to understand how Earth-like planets form, how they live, and in the end, what happens when they die. And all that information is in this atmosphere. And in our generation, the next 10 to 15 years, if we're lucky, we'll be able to answer the question whether or not on some of the planets out there, we can find signs of habitability, and hopefully we'll be able to answer the question whether or not there's life. Thank you very much.